Hello, good afternoon. Welcome back to the third lecture of Database Management System. I am Dr. Vijay Kalmani, Principal of Jain Polytechnic, Belagavi here. Just to refresh my previous classes, what we have seen in our previous classes. In our previous classes, we did see about database users. We have seen actors on the screen. We have seen workers behind the screen, actors on the screen, such as your database administrators, database designers, actors like end users. Again, end users were categorized into casual users or naive or parametric users, sophisticated users, standalone users. Also, we did see about advantages of using the database approach. Some advantages like sharing of data among multiple users, restricting unauthorized access to data, providing persistent storage for program objects, providing storage structures for efficient query processing, providing backup and recovery services, providing multiple interfaces to different classes of users, representing complex relationships among data, enforcing integrity constraints on the database, etc. Well, also we have seen some additional implications on using this database approach, that is potential for enforcing standards, reduced application development time, flexibility to change the data structure, availability of current information, economics of scales. And also we have seen in the last lecture, when to use a database, when not to use a database. So there were some instances that were described, like main inhibitors, that is the cost and overhead for providing generality, security, concurrency control, recovery and integrity functions. And sometimes it becomes unnecessary for a DBMS application to be used if the database and applications are simple, well-defined and not expected to change. Or if there are some stringent real-time requirements that may not be met because of DBMS overhead. Well, going on to the next topic in the first unit, that is database system concepts and architecture. This is the B part of the unit one, that is database system concepts and architecture. Here in this chapter, sub-chapter of unit one, we will be studying data models and their categories, history of data models, schemas, instances, and states, three schema architecture, data independency, DBMS languages and interfaces, database system utilities and tools, centralized and client server architecture and classification of DBMS. Well, one fundamental characteristics of the database approach is that it provides some level of data abstraction. Now, what is this data abstraction? It generally refers to the separation of detail of data organization and storage, and the highlighting of the essential feature for an improved understanding of data. One main characteristics of database approach is to support database abstraction so that different users can perceive data at their preferred level of detail. We'll see some definitions, like what is a data model? A data model, a collection of concepts, it's a collection of concepts that can be used to describe the structure of a database. It provides the necessary means to achieve this abstraction. By structure of a database, we mean the data type, relationships, and constraints that apply to the data. Most data models can also include a set of basic operations for specifying retrievals and updates on the databases. In this slide, we will see the categories of data models. Now, there are three categories of data models. The first one being the high level or conceptual data model. The second one being the low level, or also we call it as physical data model. And the third one being the representational, or also we call as the implementational data model. Now, in the first level, that is the high level or the conceptual data model, it uses concepts such as entities, attributes, and relationships. We will define what are these entity, what are this attribute and relationship. An entity represents a real world object or concept, such as an employee or a project that describes in the database. Attribute represents some property of interest that further describes an entity, such as the employee name or salary. And a relationship among two or more entities represents an association among the entities. For example, a works on relationship between an employee and a project. Say there are two tables, employee table and project table. So definitely there will be some relationship between this employee table, some attributes of entities and attributes of employee table will be associated in the project table. The second one is the low level or physical, also called as internal data model. It provides concepts that describe of the details of how a data is stored on the computer storage media, typically the magnetic disks. Concepts provided by low-level data models are generally meant for computer specialists and not for the end users. Physical data models describe how data is stored as files in the computer by representing information such as record formats, record orderings, and access paths. An access path is nothing but, again, it is a structure that makes the search for particular data records efficient. The third one is the representational or implementational data model. Well, it provides the concepts that may be easily understood by the end users. Representational data model hide many details of data storage on disk, but it can be implemented on a computer system directly. It represents data by using record structures and hence are sometimes called record-based data models. Well, let's go to the next slide. Here we will try to define what is a schema, instance, and database state. Well, in any data model, it is important to distinguish between the description of the database and the database itself. Now, the description of the database is called as the database schema. So, database schema is nothing but the description of the database, which is specified during database design, and it is not expected to change frequently. Well, a displayed scheme is called a schema diagram. So, schema diagram, you can see it here. You can see this is a schema diagram. You have student table, course table, prerequisite table, section, grade report. Now the diagram there in this, it displays the structure of each record type, but not the actual instances of that records. Each object in the schema, such as student or course, is called as schema construct. So we define the schema construct now. A component of the schema or an object within the schema, that is student or course. The data in the database at a particular moment in time is called a database state or a snapshot. So we call this as a database state. So the actual data stored in the database at a particular moment in time. It is also called current set of occurrences on instances in the database. So we have database schema versus database state. So database state refers to the content of a database at a time in, at a moment of time. Initial database state is, it refers to the database state when it is initially loaded into the system, and a state that satisfies the structure and constraints of that database is nothing but a valid state. So schema is also called as intention or extension. So this is an example of the database schema that we saw in the earlier. This is example of a database state. Well, going to the next slide, we will see a three schema architecture. The goal of this three schema architecture, you can see here a three schema architecture, is to separate the user applications from the physical database. So this is the physical database here, stored database, and these are the users. In this architecture, schemas can be defined at following three levels. So we have the internal level schema, internal level, the conceptual level, and the external level or the view level. The internal level has an internal schema which describes the physical storage of a structure of the database. The internal schema uses a physical data model and describes the component, the complete details of data storage and access paths to the database. So this is the internal schema. So in the internal schema, you can see there is a physical storage of the data on the storage units like your magnetic disks. So it keeps information about actual representation of the entire database, that is actual storage of data on the disk in the form of records. The conceptual level as a conceptual schema which describes the structure of whole database for a community users. Now this conceptual schema hides the details of physical storage structures and concentrates on describing entities, data types, relationships, user operations, and constraints. Now this level lies between the internal level and the external level. So this is the conceptual level The conceptual level describes the structure of the database for a community of users, and it hides the details of the physical storage structure, that is that what is available at the internal schema. Well, the external schema or view level, it includes the number of external schemas or user views. Each external schema here describes the part of the database that a particular user group is interested in and hides the rest of the database from the user group. Example, accounts department may only be interested in student fee details. It could not have any interest in his personal information. So the users, as per their needs, you can see they are the people who are going to use this application at the external level. In a database management system based on the three schema architecture, each user group refers to its own external schema. Hence, the DBMS must transform a request specified on an external schema into a request against the conceptual schema, and then into a request to the internal schema for processing over the stored database. If the request is database retrieval, the data extracted from the stored database must be reformatted to match the user's external view. So the process of transforming requests and results between levels are called as mapping. So mappings among the different requests and results. Data independency. So in the next slide, we see the data. So data independency can be defined as the capacity to change the schema at one level of the database system without having to change the schema at the next higher level. Now, why this data independency is needed? It is needed because actually, if database system is not a multi-layer, it becomes difficult to make changes in the database system, and hence multi-layer architecture is used, and also database system are designed in multi-layer. Now there are two types of data independencies. One is the logical data independency, and the other one is the physical data independency. Logical data independency. Well, is the capacity to change the conceptual schema without having to change the external schema or application programs. It stores information about how data is managed inside. We may change the conceptual schema to expand the database by adding a record type or data item, to change constraints or to reduce the database by removing the record type or data item. For example, any changes into database table should not change data on the disks. Physical data independency. Now, it is the capacity to change the internal schema without having to change the conceptual schema. Hence, the external schema need not be changed as well. Changes to the internal schema may be needed because some physical files were reorganized. For example, by creating additional access structures to improve the performance of retrieval or update. An example here is change in the internal schema that is different file organizations or internal storage device or structure of storage is possible without affecting external or conceptual schema. So when a schema is at a lower level is changed, only the mappings between this schema and higher level schemas need to be changed in a database that fully supports the data independency. However, the higher level schemas themselves are unchanged. Hence, the application programs need not be changed since they refer to only the external schemas. Next slide, we talk about DBMS languages. DBMS languages like DDL, that is data definition language, data manipulation languages. Then we talk about storage definition languages, view definition languages, and I hope we'll see you one by one. Data definition language. Once data design of a database is completed and a DBMS is chosen to implement database, first step is to specify conceptual and internal schemas for the database and any mappings between the two. In many DBMSs, where no strict separation or levels is maintained, one language called the DDL, that is data definition language, is used by the DBA and by database designers to define both schemas. The DBMS will have a DDL compiler whose function is to process DDL statements in order to identify descriptions of schema constructs and to store schema description in the database catalog. Now the commands here used are the DDL command, for example. You'll be studying them in the SQL also. Like the create command is there, the create table command is there, alter table command is there, drop table command is there, etc. So the data manipulation language. Once the database schemas are compiled and the database is populated with data, users must have some means to manipulate the database. Typical manipulations include retrieval of the data, insertion of records or deletion of records or modification of the data. So the DBMS provides a set of operations or a language called the data manipulation language, DML, for these purposes. Now the commands, the SQL, that is structured query language, commands that you use here are select, insert, update, delete, etc. You will see it in the fourth chapter. Now there are two types of data manipulation languages. One is the high level, also called as non-procedural languages, and the second one is low level, or also called as the procedural languages. Well, DML can be used to specify complex database operations. Many DBMS allow high level DML statements either to be entered interactively from a display monitor or a terminal, or to be embedded in a general purpose programming language. In the latter case, DML statements must be identified within the program so that they can be extracted by a pre-compiler and processed by the DBMS. The next one is the low level or the procedural language. Typically, a DML, this type of DML typically retrieves individual records or objects from the database and processes them separately. Therefore, it needs to use programming language constructs such as looping to retrieve and process each record from a set of records. So low-level DMLs are also called as record at time database manipulation language DML because of this property. So DDL, in short, also I could like to just explain you about this storage definition languages and view definition languages. So in some DBMSs, separate storage definition languages and view definition languages are used to define internal and external schema. So SDDL, what we say storage definition language, in DBMS, where a clear separation is maintained between the conceptual and internal levels, the DDL is used to specify the conceptual schema only. So another language, the SDL, is used to specify the internal schema. So the SDLs are used to define the internal schema, whereas the VDL, view definition languages, are used to define the external schemas. We have seen these types of DML statements. We'll now see the DBMS interfaces. Well, user-friendly interfaces provided by a DBMS may include the following. You may have menu-based interface, form-based interface, graphic-based interface, natural language interface, speech input-output, interface for parametric users, interfaces for the DBA, etc. Well, we will see one by one these different types of interfaces. Menu-based interface. These interfaces present the user with a list of options called as menus that lead the user through the formulation of a request without need to memorize the specific commands and syntax of query language, rather than the query is composed step by step by picking options from a menu that is displayed by the system. So you have seen these menu-based interfaces in a lot of your application programs. Today you are generating challan to fill up your exam forms, K2 challan. So you have, when you go there to the government website K2, you have menus, different types of menus are there. And from there, then you pick up challan generation, isn't it? So you have different steps to be performed. Form-based interfaces. So here, a form-based interface displays form to each user, and user fills out that the form entries to insert new data, or they can fill out only certain entries, in which case a DBMS will retrieve matching data for the remaining entries. The example, again, the best example is when you have gone to fill up the examination form on the K2 challan, you fill up your name, you fill up your address, then you go and search for the department there. You say Department of Technical Education, then it populates which directorate of technical education, all these things. Then you choose board of technical examination, then you choose full exam fee, part exam fee, whatever it is. So this is a form-based DBMS application that you can see. Now this graphical user interfaces, they typically display a schema to the user in a diagrammatic form so that the users can specify a query by manipulating the diagram. Then there are next natural processing interfaces. These interfaces accepts requests written in English or some other language and attempt to understand them. You have speech input output. Now this type of interfaces are limited. They use limited use of speech as an input query, and this speech as an answer to a question or result of a request is becoming a commonplace. Now you have this type of inputs on your Google also. You just type Google, open me the contacts. It opens the contacts for you from that, you know, cell phone or whatever it is. Interfaces for parametric users. Parametric users such as your bank clerks have a small set of operations. Now that must be performed repeatedly. So the system analysts and programmers, what they do is they design and implement a special interface for each known class of these name users. So in a bank, you have different type of users, and different type of users, they have different tasks to be performed, and each task is having its own interface. Interfaces for the database administrator. Now, the database administrator is a person who is having high privileges of maintaining the databases. He is a person who maintains the databases. So he uses some system-oriented privilege commands, which can be only used by the DBA. So you need to have one interface for the DBA. Well, so database system utilities. Now, to perform certain functions such as loading data stored in files into a database includes data conversion tools, backing up of database periodically, reorganizing the database file structure, report generation utilities, performing monitoring utilities, other functions such as sorting, user monitoring, data compression, etc. There are set of tools available for all such things. If you are using any database applications, definitely I'm sure you might have used one or the other these type of tools. If you open an Excel sheet, you can do sorting, you can do some filtering in that. I cannot give you an example of an Excel tool, but any other database tool also you can use. You'll find all these things. We will see now a typical database component modules here. Well, before I go to the next slide, I just want to ask if anyone has any questions here. On these slides, what I have shown you now, anybody can ask me any questions.
No, sir. No, sir.
No questions. Okay. Acha. So let's go. So other tools are there. Data dictionary or repository. So data dictionary or repository is used to store the schema descriptions and other information such as design decisions, application program descriptions, user information, user standards, etc. Data dictionaries, you can have two types of data dictionary. One is the active, another one is the passive. Active is usually accessed by the DBMS software and users, such as a DBA, including a DBA. Passive is accessed by users and DBA only. Other tools are examples we have given here, Sybase, JBuilder, Oracle. Oracle can, J developer in Oracle 10G. That's a very nice tool. We'll now see typical DBMS component module. Well, the figure here illustrates the typical DBMS components. The figure is divided into two parts. The top part figure refers to the users and the database environment and their interfaces. And the lower part shows the internals of the DBMS responsible for storage of data and processing of transactions. So you can say, the upper part and the lower part. Okay, these are the upper part. You have the different users here. And in the lower part, you have the storage. So let us consider the top part of this figure. Now it shows the interfaces for the DBA staff. Here you can see the DBA staff is there. Casual users, application programmers, and the parametric users. Now the DBA staff works on defining the database and making changes to its definitions using the DDL and other privileged commands. So there are DDL statements and privileged commands. So the DDL statement, now it uses the DDL compiler to process schema definitions specified in the DDL statements and stores the description of these of the schema in the DBMS catalog. Here you can see. Okay, so this catalog includes information such as, this is the system catalog. So this system catalog includes information such as names and size of files, names and database, data types of data items, storage details of each file, mapping information among schemas, and other constraints, if any constraints are there. Then the casual users. The casual users and people with are the people with occasional need of information from the database, interact using some form of interface, which we call it as an interactive query. Interactive queries are parsed and validated for correctness of the query syntax, the name of files and data elements, and so on, by a query compiler that compiles them into an internal form. So the internal query is subjected to query optimization. So the query optimizer, this query optimizer, is concerned with the rearrangement and possible reordering of operations, elimination of redundancies, and use of correct algorithms and indexes during execution. So it consults the system catalog. So you can see there is an interface between the optimizer and the system catalog. It consults the system catalog for information about stored data and generates executable code that performs the necessary operations for the query and makes calls on the runtime processor. The next are the application programmers. Now these users, they write programs in host languages such as your, it may be Java, C, C++, etc. that are submitted to a precompiler. So this is a precompiler. So it uses host languages. So the precompiler extracts the DML commands from an application program written in a host programming language. Then these commands are sent to the DML compiler for compilation into object code, what we call it as an object code for database access. The object codes of for these DML commands and the rest of the program are linked, forming a chained transaction whose executable code includes calls to the runtime database compiler. So you can see DML compiler also uses information from the system catalog, right? Now in the lower part, you can see this is the lower part. In the lower part of the figure, the database, the DBMS consists of a runtime database processor. It executes privileged commands and executable query plans and the chain transactions with runtime parameters. It works with the system catalog and may update it with statistics. So it usually works with the system catalog. It also works with the stored manager. So you can see this is a stored manager here. So the database runtime data processor executes the privileged commands, the executable query plans, and the chain transactions with runtime parameters. It works with the system catalog, also works with the stored manager, which in turn uses basic this systems, the stored data manager uses basic operating services for carrying out low level IO, that is read write operations between the disk and the main memory. Well, the concurrency control and backup recovery system. Now here it is shown separately as a module in this figure. You can see it's a separate module here. They are integrated into the working of the runtime database processor for purposes of transaction management. So this is typically a database DBMS component. So you have seen the DBMS components of the DBMS, different components, the users, and the you have the query and transaction execution, upper part and the lower part. Upper part are users, lower part is the stored system. Well, in the next slide, we will see the centralized and client server DBMS architecture. Any questions regarding DBMS components? Any doubts? Okay. The centralized DBMS architecture. Now, earlier architecture used mainframe computers to provide main processing for all system functions like user application and user interface programs and DBMS functionality. Earlier we had mainframe computers now are very lightly used in the market. All processings were performed remotely on computer systems and display informations were sent from computer to display terminals which were connected to central computers via various types of communication networks. The best example here was old system in on the railway reservation platforms. Computers not having, only having the processing unit, but not the storage system. The centralized server was there, and these, you know, are linked to the main server there for reservation. Only you could see the interface. Then my railway reservations. Now, as prices of hardware declined, most users replaced their terminals with PCs and workstations. So terminals are, you know, computers without storage units. They only process, and most of the processing, the backend processing, is done on the servers, like mainframe computers. At first, database systems used these computers like display terminals, so that DBMS itself is centralized. DBMS, in which all the DBMS functionalities, application program execution, and user interface processings were carried out on one machine. You can see here a physical centralized architecture. Now, here you can see the terminals, the display monitors, and you had the application programs, the software, different softwares here, and the operating system. Well, basic client server architecture. The client server architecture was developed to deal with computational environment in which a large number of PCs, workstations, file servers, print servers, database servers, web servers, email servers, and other software and equipments were connected via a network. Here you can see all these servers. You had a print server, you had a file server, DBMS server. All these servers were connected to clients via some network. The idea here is to define specialized servers with specific functionalities. For example, it is possible to connect a number of PCs or small workstation as clients to a file server that maintains the files of the client machine. And another machine can be designated as a print server by being connected to various printers. So all print requests by the clients are forwarded to this machine. Whereas web servers or email servers, they also fall into the specialized server category. The resources provided by specialized servers can be accessed by the client machines. So now these client machines, they provide the users with the appropriate interface. What are these clients? Clients are machines. Now these machines provide the users with the appropriate interfaces to utilize these servers, as well as with the local processing power to run local applications. So I have, I don't have one. I missed out one diagram. Okay. Now some machines could be client sites only, for example, diskless workstations or workstation PCs with disk that have only client software installed. Other machines could be dedicated servers, and other could be have both client and server functionality. So client is in this framework is typically a user machine that provides user interface capabilities and local processing. When a client requires access to additional functionalities such as database access, that does not exist at that machine, it connects to a server that provides the needed functionality. And then what is a server? Server is a system connecting both hardware and software that can provide services to the client machines, such as file accessing, printing, database access, etc. So usually clients connect to the servers via some network like your LAN, WAN, etc. So server, I said it, a DBMS server, it provides database query and transaction services to clients. These DBMS servers are often called as SQL servers, structured query language servers, or query servers, or transaction servers also. Well, the applications running on the clients utilize a client API to access server databases via standard interfaces such as your ODBC or JDBC. So you are using this ODBC connections in your third semester lab, that is DBMS software. You will be connecting a database server with an application program such as a Visual Basic. JDBC, you can try it in the next semester. You can do some work on it. Well, client and servers must install appropriate client modules and server modules such as ODBC or JDBC. Whenever you install any software, they come with it. We'll see. The next slide talks about two-tier client-server architecture. And after this, I think we should stop. Well, in relational DBMS, that is RDBMS, Relational Database Management System, the system components such as a user interface and application program were first moved to the client side. Now, because SQL provided a standard language for RDBMS, this created a logical dividing point between client and server. In an RDBMS, the server is often called as an SQL server. The user interface programs and application programs, they can run on the client machines, client side. When DBMS access is required, program establishes a connection to the DBMS, which is on the other side of the, which is on the other server side. Once the connection is created, the client program can communicate with the DBMS. So a standard interface, as I said in my earlier top slide, that is open database connectivity, ODBC, or it provides an application program interface, API, which allows client-side programs to call the DBMS as long as both client and server machines have the necessary software installed. So you have a user interface and you have a DBMS which need to interact. A client program can actually connect to several RDBMSs and send query and transaction requests using the ODBC API, which are then processed at the server side. So any query results that are sent back to the client program, which can display or which can process and display the results as needed. So relatively one standard example also I told you about the JDBC also here. This is also one standard interface for Java programming language. So this allows Java client programs to access one or more DBMSs through the standard interface. So the architecture here are called two-tier because the software components are distributed over two systems, that is the client and the server. So advantage of this two-tier architecture? Is it simplicity and compatibility with existing systems? So I think today we should stop here. Thank you. If you have any queries, please let me know.